हाय,
गुड इवनिंग सर, दिस इज बिमल। हाय
वेलकम
हाय एवरीबॉडी, थैंक
वेलकम बिमल बिमल
यू सो मच।
कुमार। डॉक्टर सैयद यू जस्ट इनवाइटेड दिस आफ्टरनून एंड न्यू हॉलैंड यू नो सीएनएच इंडिया एंड वेरी डेडिकेटेड एग्रीकल्चर इंजीनियर। ही ऑलवेज ही इज अनदर फार्मर सेंट्रिक पर्सन। ही ऑलवेज टॉक what all we are doing, and I had a 1 hour talk, you know, long talk today with him, and regarding what is going on, particularly with rice issue in Punjab. I just told him that Haryana at least banned rice, so his concern is that Punjab should ban, and this is the opportunity for these governments to shift from, you know, this one regime to, you know, other cropping patterns, so that farmers get benefited. At the same time, sustainability issue is addressed.
Yes.
And the governments very well know that they are going to destroy their soil, their water, and their environment. All three, they are going to destroy. But
I think you are right. The main problem is in India. Like recently, I found out who will take the lead, who will build the cat, like you asked.
Yeah.
So that is what we are doing. I think you are good, and we have an excellent team of people. Excellent team of people who vibrate same way. Yeah.
Hi, Bimal, Rubesh here. Good evening.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yes, yeah. Hi. Good morning.
Actually, it is belling the tiger, not the cat.
but all the cats are willing to do. Actually, cats are they show willingness. What I found is everybody is willing. Actually, the lead was missing. I think probably because
I think this forum can change. This forum is of dedicated professionals, and
yes.
You know, you guys are more competent to advise to government and department, because we as companies are looked at as, you know, having commercial interests. But probably the scientists and the other faculty can really, really suggest, because they are neutral. They are pro farmers, pro sustainability. We sometimes are not looked at as, you know, neutral. Somebody would say my suggestion is to support tractors or somebody else. So, but of course, I am more interested in how I learned from these interactions, and also my personal, it is not CNH a point of view that I would put here. It's my personal experience and my point of view. So that's, and I see a lot of my colleagues sitting there. So nice that I am getting connected with them.
Yeah, it's not about the people. We don't think they're against the industry. The main problem is there was no accountability.
Yes.
That is the problem happened. Because the industries were told within 15 days you have to deliver it, because before this particular time period you have to deliver all this stuff, install it and get a certificate. And a solution of something like 10% keep it, take it after 1 year or 5 years, that doesn't work in India. I mean, people always forget in the tenders the 10%. But I think we are in the correct direction, because not a single person has told it is doing good things. So we will go ahead. I think that's what the whole team is planning. But we should have a strong point to convert this. And whatever happened till now also, we want to rectify it back again as much as possible. I think it will work. We'll wait for another 2-3 minutes. Somebody can talk something else. 2-3 minutes. We'll wait for more people to join.
Yeah, Sayyad.
Yeah.
Regarding subsidy, what is necessary is that, like Indramani talking to different people, we should get the kind of a main theme. See, the problem is industry's requirement and farmer requirement are slightly different in financial terms. Okay. The idea is, because it's all financial system, idea is that the farmer pays when he derives benefit from that item.
Correct. Absolutely.
Because paying right in the front, then the supplier kind of forgets him. Okay. That's what happened. If we develop a mechanism where farmer will be paying installment based on, okay, mean, he sells his crop, so he makes some money and then he pays, okay? So something has a 20-year life, so then it should be spread over at least 5 years or maybe 10 years.
Yes.
Like tractor is spread up to 10 years and things like that. So the payment from the beneficiary, the farmer, and the banking system and the government is a kind of a guarantor.
Correct.
Okay. So rather than paying everything front, so I think some discussion, some points. So it's not the idea of finding faults. The approach has to be what are the deficiencies in the system and how we fill those loopholes and how to improve it. Okay. I think if we take that positive approach, so we can take farmers' attitude, farmers, what they want. We can take industry because they want money right in front. Okay. The banks and government, I think. Okay.
That's excellent. I think the same thing what I was proposing, like for example of the solar pump case, the farmer does not know what he wants, whether he wants DC system or AC system, and the manufacturers, they are good. I'm not saying in any of the 7-8 listed manufacturers are bad. They delivered, but the problem is logistics there and giving support afterwards and collection of what is the problem they are facing. And simple questions like 4.5 inch bore must be changed to 6-inch bore. The problems what they face, reinvestment, and putting in where the power was not there. This all could be done in the, at least corrected in the future. I think our outlook is always looking not negative because subsidies are existing from 1990. I have seen, like I told, solar water heater. So it has been for so many years. But I think the problem was coordination only problem. The economists sitting there, bankers sitting there, and few manufacturers sitting there. There was no engineers presence actually, or the guy in the field. Probably we'll fill in the blanks. I think that's my opinion.
Yeah. Dr. Sayed, this is Murthy here. Can I add a few things on that?
Yeah, of course.
Sure. So when as I was preparing the brief for the group, one of the things I realized was essentially we have our water systems, like for irrigation, drip irrigation and things like that, for which there is a lot of subsidy. And then we have the solar pumping, for which there is another subsidy. And these two ministries don't really talk to each other. One of the things I think should be happening is these two should be coordinated in the sense that there should be training to people who will do the system design and actually deliver it that way. And then as Professor Gajendra Singh was mentioning earlier, key thing would be to have that maintenance and repeated basically follow-up. And the subsidies perhaps should be paid only in installments and stuff like that.
Okay. Good. I think that's the same thing we had also other people in our tech group was telling this similar opinion. Let us now, I think we are time to start now.
Sure.
We'll end of it. I think Indramani is going to brief everyone. I think we will start now. Actually today, welcome all of you friends. And like I told you, we are live on YouTube also. Today we have an interesting topic. Again, continuing an automation line. The first one is about the food, actually the quality. So how do you see the quality as well as the food safety? Actually, food processing is one of the areas which can extensively use the electronics or technology automation. And we do have some of the areas already technology available, but India needs much more. For example, India doesn't export that much of fruits or whatever vegetables you see to outside than other countries. So there's a big potential for us to improve on it. So the speaker, we have a speaker. Afterwards, we have a second speaker who will talk on soilless cultivation, which in line with the vertical farming, which we, as we already told about, it's about the polyhouses, how to use them. And we all know that vertical farming is profitable, polyhouses are profitable, how to bring it. So we have two speakers. I would now hand over to Dr. Indramani to introduce the first speakers. Let's start.
Thank you, Dr. Sayed, Professor Singh, and friends. Today we have two speakers, as mentioned by Dr. Sayed, Dr. Resan Jha, ADG Process Engineering, and Dr. Murtaza Hassan, our principal scientist, ERI. And one thing is common in both are from RPCAU Pusa. So we have two speakers for Saturday. Dr. Jha is here.
Yes.
So friends, everybody knows Dr. Jha. Dr. Jha, SN Jha is ADG presently at the headquarters in SMD. He is at ADG Process Engineering. And he has contributed a lot significantly in national and international issues, policy making, formulating central sector schemes of agriculture processing in the country, and is a member of numerous scientific panels, governing bodies. This is contribution as ADG, but he has been a very decorated scientist. The area on which he is going to speak, he is master in that. He has done a wonderful piece of work. And his contributions has been, patented, and he has four patents granted, five registration, and four patents are in process. And he has been decorated by Rafi Ahmad Kidwai Award and NRDC Award, NAS recognition, so many. So as I said, he's a very, very recognized scientist with number of citations, H index, one of the best in agriculture in the country. So we have a very fitting speaker today. And since processing is going to be very a core area, and my dear friends, very recently, that government has given a lot of emphasis, and I was discussing with my friends and in industry today also that what to do. Means, the government is going to invest 1 lakh crore rupees for restructuring this farm gate infrastructure, providing lot many things. So that needs engineering, that needs technology. And we know that a lot of losses are there. There is a lot of euphoria and happiness that all these changes by government will benefit the system. But technology is needed. And the area which is going to talk today is very important for quality evaluation of fruits and vegetables. And ICR has recently started another program on this that how to give more emphasis on this. And already we had a talk from Dr. Nachiket. He presented on a similar line. So Dr. Jha's presentation will be today more comprehensive, and he will be in the last we would like to listen that how it is going to help both in the country and the quality evaluation and export also, because I had a meeting in APIDA, and they want this kind of technology to ensure that particularly mango, Dr. Jha, that many times a lot gets rejected because there are unseen problems inside, which are physically it looks very good, but there are inside there are injuries and other things. So we will see that how his talk becomes very effective from the this in the area of food technology, as we are talking quality and value addition. Now with this, I request Dr. Jha to start his presentation. Dr. Jha, please. Dr. SN Jha.
Thank you, Dr. Indramani. Let me share. I have to share the screen first.
Yes, Dr. Jha, you can share the screen. Share screen. You press the share screen. It will show you the.
Okay. Is it coming?
Yes, it's coming. You make the slideshow now.
Okay.
You run the slideshow. It will. Thank you.
So thank you, Dr. Indramani, Dr. Sayyad, and Professor Gajendra Singh, and namaskar to everyone. Actually, this is my pet subject since 20 years now, we can say. I started and brought this subject in the country in 2002, though I was working since 2000, exactly 2000. And non-destructive techniques for food quality and safety. A very important subject. Initially, people were not understanding, so I did not go on population and food directly on that. Already, Dr. Indramani, I told that food losses are too much, 5 to 16%, and 92,651 crores per annum. up to the retail marketing. It is not in the kitchens and other places. So if we know the quality, and particularly now I am emphasizing on the maturity and ripeness when to harvest, that if we can know digitally, then it will be very good and it will help much in saving the losses. So how to reduce post-harvest losses, what is quality, how can it determine rapidly, that is more important. Usually we determine quality by experience. We say that that fruit is sweeter than this compared, we see it, and then sometimes we're using the brands, but every time this is not good. So what is the quality? That actually has to be defined so that we can measure it. Till now it is perceptions, and we have given the definitions. So quality can be viewed particularly as an absence of defects or a degree of excellence. In any way you can define it. Quality means actually different things to different handlers. During the chain of the marketing, from harvest to marketing, and there are different handlers. Everyone is having their own meaning of quality based on their requirement for getting the more and more profits. And food quality, particularly, not only fruit and vegetable, embraces sensory attributes that are rapidly perceived by human senses, and hidden attributes such as safety and nutrition. Now, safety is more important than the quality and nutrition. Safety is the first, nutrition is the second, then come to the physical quality. Quality of food, including fruits and vegetables, changes as it proceeds from harvest to consumer, we all know. So how to define the quality? Quality can be defined or measured in two ways. Product-oriented quality, a series of attributes selected on the basis of accuracy and precision of measurements, which usually we scientists do. Consumer-oriented quality, quality in terms of consumer, that is satisfaction, much less tangible and less quantifiable concept. Consumers comparing criteria is the cost, though 4 C's are more important for consumers. And many times, then we think that which is the better. Of course, the consumer-oriented quality determination is better, but it's very difficult to determine. So usually we try to determine the quality based on the product-oriented, and then we try to correlate with the consumer preference. Then how to measure the quality? There are so many methods as quality attributes products. For example, sweetness, sourness, firmness, and whatever you want, color. There are so many things. So when you go for buying the things, you don't have time to measure all those things. It is really very difficult to enumerate all the quality parameters and determine before purchase and procurements and supply or even the exports. So broadly, we divide the quality determination technique, destructive methods and non-destructive methods. Destructive methods are those methods which are lab methods. We have to determine, we have to use each lab methods, that is wet chemistry method, for each attributes individually. Non-destructive method, in which the quality parameters of a samples can be measured, but sample does not get destroyed. It can be reused. In destructive method, we don't reuse. So why non-destructive methods? Samples are not destroyed. It is most of the time non-touch. It is very rapid, quick, almost instantaneous, and we can determine simultaneously many parameters by click of a button. And of course, online applicability of bulk, for bulk handling, packaging, sorting, grading is there, and precision sorting in decimals and percentage, you can determine and do it. And most importantly, we can do the pricing based on the quality parameters. Suppose if we say that this product is having more and more protein contents, and some person is protein deficient, we can market that product based on the protein content and not based on the overall quality. There are so many techniques. Many people understand that techniques are very costly, and some of them I have enumerated them. Optical techniques, electrical technology based technique, acoustic, that is sound based, nuclear magnetic resonance, machine vision system, X-ray and computer tomography, which we have used for medical purposes, and near infrared spectroscopy, on which we have worked, and some others which are very cheap, maybe very cheap, and we can work on that, and individual based product, we can develop the techniques. What is optical technique? This method is based on optical properties used for determination of gloss, color, morphological attributes for fruits and vegetables. It is useful for sorting of a small grain in bulk based on reflection, absorption of light of certain wavelength. This is the arrangement of equipment. We can do that and we can measure. Then gloss meter, we can arrange. If you have the gloss meter, a spectroradiometer, and just we can have an one spectroradiometer, one receptor, and one computer. We can have a sample holders fabricated locally. We can hang one sample and we can get the spectrometer. We can get the curve, and then we have to analyze that, what is the glossiness, and then glossiness can be calibrated with the help of with the statistics in terms of you can say the freshness and price. Then electrical technology, electrical conductivity, we all know. Electrical resistance, we know. Electrical impedance, dielectric constant, and all these can be determined and correlated with the moisture content or the gloss or weight loss, whatever else. Only desirability is low frequency range required, that is 100 hertz to 1000 kilohertz. And drawback is data instability in this electrical technology because of the moisture range of agro commodities very high. So that this one kind of watermelon sorting machine I had seen in Japan. There I had taken the photograph. And then water density sorting system in a pack house, based on electrical properties, that whether it is sweet or less sweet, that we can determine, then we can package accordingly. Then acoustic response works on principle of sound product produced on striking the fruit, useful for maturity on other quality parameter, apple, melon, pineapple. Again, here drawback is difficult to difference and not applicable in soft ripened fruit have ripened more, then it is very difficult to. And this is the kind of this muskmelon, just strike from one side, microphone can catch that sound, and then we can amplify, and then we can get the signal in form of a spectra or curve, and then that can be analyzed and equation can be made to find out the maturity and ripeness and any other attributes. Then machine vision system, already Nachiket has given in detail, already you have seen. So I think he was one of the group member in our NAIP project, so he might have given you the detail. So I'll not go in detail. So this is the image analysis systems which we had fabricated, and we can monitor and we can do the sorting grading based on the image of the, all these experiments are mangoes collected from throughout the India. Then another color camera systems, phenotype. You all know that how we can segregate any fruit or vegetable based on the color, and a phenotype key conveyor which can reject or accept the sample, and we can have a different quality packages different, and we can package them differently and price them accordingly. This is the our technology, very low technology, calorimeter based, and this is also patent granted and commercialized by one of the company, image analysis company. This is the patent number. Just simple color meter, if you have, you can get the color, and then if you have the calorimeter, you can read and we can calculate based on the TSS DM. And this is the color chart for this one. If you have the L, B value and A value, you can just see the what is the maturity of this mango from 60% to around 150% maturity varies, and you can calculate, even the illiterate person can see the maturity. And another maturity index we calculated based on the total soluble solids and dry matter content and total acidity of the mango, which can also be predicted using the NIR spectrometer. Later I will come. So this is a simple calorimeter, and within the visible range we can do it. Then another simple using calorimeter, yellowness index of fruits can be calculated X and Z. And we calculate this X and Z value, we can get the from the calorimeter. We can get from calorimeter, we can get the storability conditions of fruits and acidity using the TSS. Similarly, we can get the freshness index of the brinjal, that is egg fruits, surface gloss ratio, stiffness ratio, and density ratio divided by density ratio. And this freshness ratio can be correlated with the price of the brinjal. And similar thing can be done for other fruits. So what should be the price with the 100% fresh brinjal, and what should be with the 10% fresh brinjals? And this can be achieved, this can be utilized in the supermarket for daily price changing in the packets. Then X-ray system, computer tomography, you all have gone through. And we had also developed one X-ray system. Then this is the CT machine in which we have tested the mango. As Dr. Inmani was talking, inside of the mango, that is soft tissue, or sometimes some microbes we found. And that's why our consignment get rejected. So CT scans and MRI we have tested, but that is costly, and lab type of MRI or CT machines are not yet available commercially, so this is difficult. So we left them after testing. Of course, that is very good test. Then nuclear magnetic resonance, already I've talked. This is the instrument where we have tested, and it is better than the X-ray system, it is better than the image analysis, but it's a costly system. Then near infrared spectroscopy, on which we have worked a lot. It is very good for chemical constituent, protein, vitamin, total soluble solids, and anything you can determine using this. Non-destructive and non-touch method, easy and relatively less costly than others. This NIR wavelength, that is 700 to 25 nanometer, you can see. And middle IR and far infrared. We have also worked on far infrared and FTIR and many other techniques, but this presentation is within the 700 to 2500. Theory, if you know simple, how the NIR work, that is simple light theory, interaction of radiation with the matter. Yeah. Then how it interact, that diffuse reflectance, Snell's theory. We are applying that with Beer-Lambert's law, we have to see. And actually C and H and OH bond is more important. If any carbon bond, that CH and OH bond, their NIR can work very well. Due to lack of time, I'm not going much in theory. So actually this vibrate, and then we get the infrared spectra, and then that infrared spectra, that absorption, and this absorption can be converted into a transmittance, then that transmittance absorbance can be calculated. This is the spectrometer transmittance mode systems for that is light source, wavelength, sample in between detector, then the computers, then reflectance. You can have this kind of things for solid samples, and we can get the graph. So these are our some of the arrangement for a whole tomato. We can get the light put on whole tomato like this, and then you can get the spectra come out from the tomato transmittance. And then this is the sensor. We can get the with the computer. We can know the acidity and sweetness of tomato. We can calculate that. And then this is the commercial Brix meter being utilized internationally. And this it can show that how accurately measured soluble solids in the wet chemistry method, then estimated by using this instrument. So similar kind of things we can develop. Then this is the water. Yeah,
Dr. Jha, I think this is an excellent academic lecture. I think the idea of this webinar is you tell us some of the very successful ones which already been tried, and then which have a tremendous potential for the community.
What kind of other
systems are needed, like your quality and safety measures. So what additional instrumentation, feedback, all that. So I think idea is to identify those areas, because that way I can give a lecture for 3 months on a class basis. That's not the idea. Idea is to pick up those technologies which you have identified, you have worked, have a tremendous potential, and some users are there, and we need further assistance, help them to grow further. Can we, because the audience in the webinar, okay, is varied, and we need to focus on practicality and then how to make it more practical, more usable, more economic. Okay.
Okay. Okay. Some.
I'm
some
sorry.
Of the,
Some
of the slides are commercial models which are being made, and why we are not making that we will cover at the end.
Okay,
sir. So this is the commercial instrument available in Japan, and it can be used for muskmelon, watermelon, also for apple, but we want to fabricate in India, and we have already given the order for this kind of instrument for making the for particularly for all the major varieties of mango, and that will be tested in India. So these are the some of the instrument which can be utilized in laboratory scales and other NIR setups. This is the spectra how we get NIR, this is for tomato juice, and then how accurately we can calibrate for actual NIR predicted and the actual acid brix ratio and NIR spectra. This curve shows that. Then orange juice we have done, and actually we are not able to fabricate the NIR systems in the country. That is the main problem. Then result, then measure here is that actually people don't know even the chemometrics, not only instrument, chemometric that we analyzes using the chemometric technique is required to be trained to our scientists, young scientists, and also to the students that likes our in curriculum. That's why I'm telling that. Then food safety, you know that food safety, how much is it important, that I am not going to use clipping artificial milk. Argemine, while in mustard, where the alteration of low value juice also being added in the high value juice, insecticide, pesticides, antibiotics in chyawanprash, many things. Food safety, we all know, and milk adulterants, also aflatoxin M1 is in our milk in many places, and petrolin apple juice are also being found. So we have opened this vistas for determination of aflatoxin M1 and other microbes loads on the fruits and vegetables using NIR spectroscopy. And now this method is being taken out. You see that some of the instrument using the FTIR, we can find out that how much sugar has been added into the juices. Actually, usually people understand the NIR cannot identify the same concentration which is naturally available. But this our findings and publication say that if the sugar is available naturally and added from outside, we can identify and catch them also. Then detection, this is how the sucrose solution added and juice with the sucrose. So different segment, these analysis, sir, you have told now, these analysis people in our group don't know how to do, though we have to educate them. That's why I have added these principal component analysis and the other analysis. Detection of soybean in our area, detection of soybean has also been found out in the natural milk. So how soybean can be detected, that has been tried, and very easily the detection limit up to 5% significant level, as low as 2% can be detected. And these can be commercialized at once if the spectrometer is available. Then detection of urea in milk, see how nicely you can detect, but you are not able to do because of the spectrometer. Then detection of aflatoxin M1 in milk. Then detection of dangerous bacteria. This is even bacteria, the microbiology does not believe that E. coli, Listeria, Salmonella, Pseudomonas can be detected using the FTIR, NIR, if we have the very good instrumentation, particularly mastery in chemometrics, then we can detect E. coli 100% in the solid sample. This is, I am telling, for wave number between 900 to 600 and mango surfaces. So a lot of around 28 microbiological tests is required for determining the microbial loads on the any fruits and vegetables or any products. So this is opening, eye-opening slides. So these are the some books we have written, and for the students and new scientists, that is for the Springer, this is for the Elsevier Science, and this is based on the our data in Indian language, but literally Indian language with the Indian data can be read for references. This is a small presentation from my side for exposure. This is for exposure for new scientists, for scientists who are trying to find a new area of work, and details of instrumentation, that is another 1 hour is required for lectures. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Jha. I think we had a interesting idea on how to measure the parameters. But I really, Dr. Jha, can you please close your screen share?
Yeah, I'm trying. To how to go
close. Yes, thank you. So we had a good talk from Dr. Jha. Like Professor Singh suggested, we have to look at more of application directly in the industry, where, or I think we had last time a webinar. We are talking about how to harvest apples and pears, and how to find out the quality is ripened or not. There were some questions. So yeah. we go to then people are talking about post-harvesting requirement also very important. They were talking. I think I would leave it to the questions for Dr. Jha. Robesh Maiti, he has please ask your question, Robesh. Just a minute.
Yeah, Dr. Jha, this is Rubesh here. Was curious that your technologies are only for industry or for a common man who is so health conscious. Are there any tools which are available for him? It's so simple. He can go to the supermarket and select his food.
Not yet. Not yet in India. We are trying to make two. One, we have given an order for mango. Handheld equipment for mango through IARI. One we are making for determination of curcumin through Indian School of Science. That may come in within a year, Indian. But in foreign country, you can find many equipment for individual parameter for individual product. One thing I will emphasize here, that here in this kind of instrument, it is not one instrument for many things. You have to train the instrument for a particular work, for a particular product, and that can be multiplied in numbers. Okay. One X-ray system we had developed in the CIE Bhopal and our project for a screening of the Alfonso tissue, Alfonso in mango, that is soft tissue, and that weevils in the stones. It was very successful, but after that project was completed and commercial application is yet to be done.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
But we are searching a partner. Of course, the order which we have given to a small startup by taking the risk to develop indigenously. But we want some big player to come. We are very much confident that these things are working and can be multiplied anytime, anywhere.
Thank you.
The instrument is not available.
Okay. Mr. Lalit, I have enabled you to speak. Yeah, you can ask your question.
Dr. Jha, this is Lalit Maheshi from Bombay.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Maheshi. Yeah. How are you?
Fine, sir. I'm trying to understand, with so much of post-harvest PhD areas of every university, ICR running so many projects, anything which has come into this domain of quality for a consumer or industrial base, and better quality retention till it reaches consumer. Any major technology has come in so far?
Quality is very vast. For particular, what you want to know, that you tell me. Particular.
No. For example, turmeric going for process.
For determination of quality, I have already told that two instruments is coming. One is from Indian School of Science, and one is through IARI from ICR.
Okay.
ICR, IAR, it may come maybe in this mango season, we'll test, and next year we'll...
We may put into operation. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Can I ask Arvind? Gaunt, please ask your question.
Sir, you mentioned about the different frequency ranges with the different graphs and all. So right now we are in the situation that where we know that is what frequency ranges are or reflectance are adulterated and what are not adulterated. Can sensor-based development can be done with that particular frequency? Because when it comes to remote sensing deals with such part. Can we do this? But can we use this methodology for food and agricultural commodities, like how sir said regarding to finding adulteration in at end user part, like in super malls, markets, and all.
Yes. For NIR, FTIR range, we can do. But for each kind of adulteration, we have to calibrate the instrument. We have to, for example, for milk, we have the wavelength, not frequency, wavelength number. Our wavelength or wave number, we know for the most of the adulterants. For most of the adulterants, and that one instrument can be made for milk, for detection, and it can be kept in the supermarket or anywhere, and by single one button, level of all adulterants can come using the FTIR NIR. But whatever you are talking about, remote sensing from slight from data taken from long away distance, that is doubtful. That is
Dr. Jha, about this milk quality, is any instrument available we can buy? Because a lot of people ask me this thing, where can they buy?
Some instrument has come through. One of the Rajasthan company developed by the Beats Pilani in our NDRI and NDIP.
Can you find out the details so we can tell other people who ask? Okay.
But there are many kits. Many kits for all adulterants has been released by NDRI that I can send you.
Oh, very good.
Yeah, we need some vendor who can supply, because a lot of people want to have it at home. Yeah.
Milk adulteration kits, not instrument. Kits are available.
Yeah.
And those available kits are being supplied by the company.
Yeah.
That I will send you by email. No,
that kit I am aware, but that's not for individual household use.
Yes, household use.
Household use.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Jha. And I have, just a minute. You want to talk, you raise your hand, I will coordinate. Dr. P.K. Sahu, you can ask your question short.
Dr. Jha, very good compilation, and you have a vast experience, and you are in the headquarters also. So my question is simple. Let us think that some of the instruments which are available outside in the Western world, and some of the instruments which are available with Japan, and you have visited Japan also. So, sometimes we talk about reverse engineering. So, can you just identify 2-3 instruments for industry sector and 2-3 instruments for consumer sector, which can be just simply brought back and reverse engineered to fit into the Indian market?
I think it's difficult for anybody to reply this question, according to me, because it's highly... Anyway, you try, please, Dr. Jha, you reply.
One thing I'll tell you very clearly, this kind of technology cannot be done at all reverse engineering. You have to develop your own, or you have to make the manufacturer, particularly whatever spectrometer-based technology that has to be made in India, or manufactured by anyone, but cannot be done the reverse engineering.
Thank you. We have another question from Dr. Sir. Narendra Shah. Dr. Narendra Shah.
Yeah, Dr. Jha, good evening. Is there any sort of case study where this product quality monitoring has enhanced the farmer's outgo or the agro industry, where the economics has sort of, the benefits have been, if there is something which you could kindly cite, one or two examples?
Sorry, this is a very common and good question, sir, because the quality-based pricing I am telling, simple we have seen, and you also might have seen everywhere, that simple grading and sorting is the one of the quality parameter, and it will give the more. If you just grade the mango based on the size, it gives the more cost, price. And particularly in Japan, I have seen in first, actually, how I selected this topic for my research. In first visit of the first supermarket, I saw an instrument kept in the one of the supermarket that is called Sunny Axis in Kochi Prefecture. They were selling the egg based on the cholesterol content. An instrument were kept there, each packet were having the written amount of percentage of cholesterol content. And costing or pricing of that packet was based on the cholesterol content. So if the instrument is kept beside that stack of the fruits or vegetables, and people will believe by measuring, then surely it will give the more cost. And I have seen in Japan, here simple grading and sorting give the more cost. So if simply we say, sir, that this mango is good for diabetic, this mango is not good for diabetic, simply this sticker will give the more cost price.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. If we can encourage Dr. Sayed and Dr. Jha, if we can sort of encourage such projects where sort of, you know, farmers outgo or the agro industry outgo, can enhance, like what Dr. Jha told the case study about Japan. Yeah, thank you.
Very well, thank you. I'll take two more questions. Anand Kumar had a question.
Sir, good evening, sir. Thank you very much. Sir, regarding that microbial detection using non-destructive method,
yes.
So what principles they will use it, how it can be adopted, sir?
Yeah, it is very difficult. Even till now, we are not able to because people are not getting convinced. It is very difficult. Actually, we are swabbing the mango.
Okay.
Taking into the water. Paper we have published in one of our indigenous journal, but internationally people are still not accepting. Swabbing, then taking the test tube and taking the graph of that. That is a spectra, of acquiring the spectra, then chemometric analysis.
Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Mr. B.V. Mohana Rao, can you ask your question short? B.V. Mohana Rao, you can ask question.
Dr. Jha is ADG engineering, so any question on policy issues can also be asked. Actually,
anything, yeah, this is my duty. You can ask.
Not only this topic, the aim of affairs process.
B.V. Mohana Rao, please ask your question. Okay, he's not asking question. I think last question I will take from Murthy. Mr. Murthy, please ask your question.
Thank you. Dr. Jha, thank you so much. So I have a more generic question in terms of how can we basically, if we wanted to collaborate with you all in terms of, because the TAG group is trying to identify some technological issues that we can address in near term. So how can we collaborate if we identify some of the issues with your division there at IRA.
If any industry wants
to collaborate. I have an IDOR just as an FIR. Thank you.
Yeah, there are two ways. You can collaborate with our institute, or you can collaborate, of course, even the ICR collaborate, then you have to work with the institute. Just you write to the DG or DDG engineering or ADG, anyone, that you want to solve your so-and-so problem of your industry, or you want to get it research conducted. And I assure, if you CC me, copy to that email or letter to me, and one MOU will be signed, and immediately it will be worked out.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Jha. Yeah, please, go ahead.
One thing I was hearing in the morning, many industry people are there. Today just I have got one call from the farmer from Bihar, because I am from Bihar. And Bihar, particularly Darbhanga, Madhubani, North Bihar, is just like a Malihabad for mango. Many of you must be knowing. One of the big farmer is ready to give the land. And we are the scientists, particularly I am ready to give the technology maybe as much as possible free. If some industry want to put the processing line there in Bihar. So one tripartite proposal is requested from the industry people. From technology side, 100% backup from ICR. I assure that because that is in my hand. Our hand, DDG Engineering will not do anything. And then the land will be given by the farmer. And DDG Engineering will not stop anything. DG will not stop anything. And we'll do it.
Thank you. Yes, Dr. Jha, thank you very much. I think Arabi will not stop this. Nobody will stop good work, what you are doing. And I appreciate very much your willingness to cooperate with the industry and with everybody. Really, it is a very warm invitation from ICR. I would like all the industry people asking questions, please go with the problems to ICR and let us see processing industry grow with technology.
Yes, sure that if the copy come to me, action will be taken within a week.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jha. I think we have time to move to the next speaker. And the next speaker, like I told you, it's about soilless cultivation. We had one webinar on vertical farming from one of the great persons, his horticulturist. Now let us listen from soilless cultivation from IRA. Dr. Indramani, please introduce.
Thank you, Dr. Sayed. The next speaker is Dr. Murtaza Hassan, our own faculty member at Division of Agricultural Engineering, and he's a principal scientist. He's working on controlled cultivation at the Center for Protected Agriculture in IRI. And his whole 21 year he has spent in this area. He has 21 years experience and on greenhouses and fertigation. He took two important training in Spain and Israel, did diploma and all these works. And he has a good number of publications in this area. And he has been decorated with awards. He has been engaged with DST, TIPAC, and other organizations and assisting these organizations in fertigation and greenhouse technology. He has started, you know, since he's my colleague, so he has started this work on soilless cultivation with the help of his students and his other colleagues. So I'm expecting that whatever he is going to talk today is what actually has been done. And that can be taken to, you know, to Indian farmers. So with this, I request Dr. Murtaza Hassan to start his presentation. Dr. Murtaza Hassan.
Dr. Hassan, you can share your slides. You press on the share screen, you can show your... Because our main host is not there today during power. Thank you. You have to...
Yes, sir.
Yeah, no, you have to run your PDF file or whatever it is in the background. Now run it.
No, it is running, I hope.
No, Google is. It's showing Google. The screen is showing Google now.
The screen is showing Google?
The desktop. You must have on the desktop your program.
Yeah, yeah. I have opened the program.
We are seeing only Google. No, we are seeing only Google. It should be in the...
It is in the desktop. Just... Is it visible now?
No, not yet. I think you stop sharing again and yes, start your program and start share.
Yeah, like,
start.
Just I am opening the file, please. Dr. Sayed, is it visible now?
No, not yet.
So can you open from your...
Dr. Hassan, first stop sharing this Google, then open it in your desktop and share it. Open the PPT file in desktop and share it. And don't go for full screen. If you go for full screen, it will not be. Okay, that's great. Now share the PPT. Open it in the desktop, then share the PPT.
So this is another part of webinar, the education.
Yes.
In your desktop, then share the PPT.
Yeah, so I am opening this.
It will be.
Okay. Come now.
Now it's
now
okay.
I have
now
shared.
It's okay.
No, I have shared actually.
Okay.
You tell me now.
Your screen.
Go up. Okay. So you tell me now because today we are handicapped. We don't have host because of the power problem because of this. We had this cyclone. So I have to manage it. Now we come back. So I think start. You tell me next. So I'll put it.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Please.
Respected chair, respected all the members. Dr. Indramani sir, head of the division, proctor in charge, and my dear colleagues. I indeed a privilege to speak in front of the parent society of Indian Society of Agriculture Engineering, and today I shall be speaking on greenhouse soil cultivation technology. I'm a faculty member in the Agriculture Engineering Division and working at present at Center for Protected Cultivation Technology. Next. Yes, the outline and major issues I shall be speaking today is on greenhouse soilless cultivation technology, present status and future prospects. I shall be speaking about in details about the technologies like soilless hydroponics and aeroponics systems, then automation with sensors and controllers, advantages and challenges, and in last, some technological and policy issues. I hope I am audible to everybody.
Yes.
So coming to the state of the topic, that is the greenhouse soilless cultivation. As we know that greenhouse cultivation is rapidly expanding in our country, and with the total estimated area is now approximately 1 lakh hectare. Due to the rapid soil-borne pathological diseases, these are the major problems in the greenhouse cultivation. And also nematodes are becoming a very serious problem. Initially, what is happening that these problems are usually coming after 5 or 6 years. But now these problems are coming within 1 to 2 years of cultivation. And we know that normally life of the greenhouse, if it is properly designed, it is about more than 25 years. And as I told you, that diseases are coming even after 1 to 2 years. And these are all soil-borne diseases. So this is making the greenhouse cultivation very tough. So that's why we have to go for the soilless cultivation. And that's why the greenhouse soilless cultivation is a long-term and lasting profitable solution. The major challenges in particularly in this type of cultivation, because we are using all the inert media, is that water and nutrient management. Because all the nutrients supplied has to be properly managed in this type of soilless cultivation. So there is a need to develop crop-specific fertigation strategies for soilless cultivation suitable for different types of crops. Coming to the present status of soilless technologies, in our country, mostly it is prevalent in the form of hydroponics, aeroponics, soilless growback technology, also known as container technology. We can grow mostly high-value vegetables, flowers, herbs, and seedlings. And most of the now common system is open loop type system. So there are two types of system basically. One is open loop and one is closed loop type. In closed loop type, what is happening that all the water and nutrients are being recirculated. So they have to be managed very well, and all its important indices related to EC, pH, TDS has to be carefully monitored. So closed loop type system is very complex and it is very difficult to manage. But open loop type system, mostly it is prevalent in our country now. And mostly there are very few sensors and controllers that we are using in the soilless cultivation. So you can say that there are absence of real sensors and controllers. And in most of the technologies in now in primitive stage, especially related to soilless cultivation technology, that is prevalent among the farmers in our country. So this is all the present status. What we are seeing that future prospect of soilless technology. Gradually, we are shifting off soilless greenhouse cultivation towards soilless due to complex soil-borne disease and nematode. And with the demand of high food yield and quality food expectations, and everywhere there is a requirement that there should be round-the-year production. So all these things can be possible in the soilless technologies, and the technology to grow high-value foods, especially the leafy green vegetables, in and around big cities, very urban cities, with very less land. So that soilless cultivation is the option here. So very urban commercial technology. We have lots of degraded soils and also rooftop space where we can go for soilless technology. So there is a tremendous prospects here in terms of the use of this technology in the degraded area and in the rooftop area. And there is lots of possibility of automation. Automation of water management, automation of all nutrients, recyclings, with the use of all different types of sensors and controllers. When we can use this technology inside the greenhouse or inside in a closed container, we can go with artificial light. There are lots of options nowadays with LED lights, and then enhancing the CO2 level inside the closed chamber. So this is another the future prospects of this area, to use now lots of new types of LED lights and different types of modern enhanced CO2 controllers. And all the soilless cultivation technologies that I told, whether it is a soilless grow bag or it is hydroponics or it is aeroponics, these are all integral component of vertical farming. And that's why this technology are very useful for the coming days. In the last webinar, Dr. Brahm Singh has talked in detail about the vertical farming. And though now we are talking about the exactly the components of vertical farming. So these are the soilless is the main, you can say, all the integral components of vertical farming. Coming to what can be grown in soilless cultivation. Technically, any plant can be grown using soilless cultivation, but mostly the things that is prevalent is the high-value vegetable crops, especially the leafy green vegetables. These are very popular. And the crops like capsicum, tomato, cucumber. Nowadays, a variety of herbs, there is a demand, strawberries, cucumbers, different types of lettuce. There are so many types of lettuce, a very common crop that is grown in the soilless cultivation. So these are the few crops that we have also tried in our center, and these are the crops that are being practiced by farmers using soilless cultivation in different parts of the country. As we are using the soilless media, so it is very important to know in detail about the what are the various soilless media that we are using, whether it is in grow bag or it is in hydroponics or aeroponics. Everywhere we have to use some soilless media. So mostly these soilless medias are cocopeat, perlite, vermiculite, and it has a very typical physical and chemical properties in details. Mostly the most of these medias are inert in nature. They have very little salts. So their EC is, you can say, it is very less. pH is almost neutral, and they are very light in the nature. So you can see that its bulk density is very low, 0.1 gram per cc. The beauty is that they have a very high air filled porosity. So we can, and they can hold a moisture a lot also. So these soilless media, they have some unique properties that help in water and nutrient management and also the in the overall management of the crops. Mostly the soilless growing media that is used is cocopeat, vermiculite, perlite, individually or in suitable combination. They have a unique properties, as I told you, that in terms of it's it being inert in nature, they have very EC is very less, very low bulk density. So these are the very some unique properties of this growing media. Coming to the use of this soilless media, the soilless medias are used a lot in the nursery, where we call that is called plug tray nursery. You can see in the few example right hand side that it is a plug tray nursery that is being grown in the inside the greenhouse with totally inert media. So we have a pro tray that are being raised on the greenhouse inside on a platform. You can see in the figure there are platforms are there, and then there are pro trays that are there. So these in so in this pro tray we grow the seedlings. Normally within 28 to 30 days, most of the horticulture crop seedlings are ready. And then if you can see the well mature seedlings in the right side, it has a very good root developed system. So now it is ready to be transplanted in the field. So that's where the beauty of this type of seedling is that it is very healthy. It has a very good root development, and then it can be transplanted anywhere, whether it is in hydroponics, aeroponics, open field, greenhouse. This technology is now becoming very popular among the farmers, among the growers. And then, as I've mentioned here, it is a potential technology also for doubling the farmer's income. Because from our experience is that from within 500 square meter nursery, greenhouse, climate control nursery, we can grow about 10 to 12 lakh nursery in 1 year, in about 8 to 10 cycles. From 500 square meter nursery, we can grow about 10 to 12 lakh nursery. And these seedlings, individually, the minimum cost is about 2 to 3 rupees, and the maximum cost is about 5 to 6 rupees. So you can imagine that within, from the small area, if the farmers are going for greenhouse for soilless cultivation for growing seedlings, it is a very potential and very good technology for the farmer. This is the slides I have prepared for the costing details of protected structures and different types of soilless system. We have different types of protected structures, whether it is shed net, naturally ventilated poly house, climate controlled poly house, and you can see in the right hand side unit cost as per the Government of India National Horticulture Mission, the unit cost per square meter is given. So you have a choice of different protected structures, either shed net or naturally ventilated or climate controlled. And for 1,000 square meter, I have given the cost in the last column for all these structures. Now we have the choice that we have to go for which type of soilless system. If we are going for hydroponic system, its cost is about 3,500 rupees per square meter. If we go for deep water culture hydroponic system, about 3,100 rupees per square meter. If the growers is going about soilless media grow bag hydroponic system, its cost is about 2,500 rupees per square meter. And then again about the Dutch bucket hydroponic system, its cost is about around 2,900 rupees per square meter. So these are the different cost of the combination of protected structures, and then also about the various types of soilless system. So anyone has the choice of growing, picking any particular type of soilless system to be grown in any particular structures. And then these two can be merged, and then we can get the rough cost. So this is about the costing details of the soilless system. Coming to the sensors for soilless farming, this is the picture of my farm, in which we are growing in the grow bag chrysanthemum flower. We are mostly using here a very typical term that is called, because there is no soil, so there is a soilless moisture sensor. So the very common moisture sensor in our country is tensiometer. But the very important thing is that tensiometer do not work at all in the soilless system, because it requires a very close and tight binding. So we have to have another type of moisture sensor that is known as soilless moisture. There are lots of fertigation sensors, EC sensors, pH sensors, some climate monitoring sensors, especially the temperature, humidity, solar radiation we require. Disease monitoring sensors are there. Some nutrition deficiency sensors, especially for major nutrients like NPK. These are available, but they are very, very costly. And then food quality sensors, we are not using it, but they can be used for soilless farming. So these are, you can see that there is a lot of scope of using different types of sensors for soilless farming. But most of these sensors are costly, and we need the indigenous sensors for soilless farming. The very simple system of the soilless system that we called grow bag and container soilless system. You can see in the picture, it's a 1 meter grow bag, and it is a plastic bag, and inside it is filled with mostly cocopeat, perlite, vermiculite, or its suitable combination. And these are very easily laid out inside the greenhouse. So we have the greenhouse in which we laid the plastic sheet, and then after that we can lay the grow bag. And you can see near the grow bag there is also a plastic container is there, in which we can fill the plastic container with the soilless system, and we can grow the crop. In your left hand side, there is a capsicum crop, and then on the right hand side you have a cucumber crop. So you have to see the view that you have a greenhouse in which we are using inside it the pan evaporimeter, and then there is a small weather monitoring station, and there is a complete system of fertigations management, mostly the drip step type fertigation management. And then we can grow. This is the very common view of the soilless system. And this is the soilless system, which is very largely used by the growers in our country. Now, what we have studied that, as I told you, that fertigation scheduling is very important. So for the crop like capsicum, we have studied that, okay, for 200 square meter area, approximately 500 plants we are using. So for each plant, if we are growing from October to May, we have calculated crop water requirement per month. And then for individually plant, how much irrigation that is needed, especially for the North Indian condition, what should be the irrigation duration, what should be the irrigation interval. So these are all things we have calculated, and we are using this system. So this is the chart for capsicum. Again, we have calculated its yield, and the good thing is that this type of system has a very high crop water productivity. So you can see that this is the yield and crop water productivity for capsicum. Similarly, we have done for this study for cucumber, calculating the yield, crop water productivity, fertigation scheduling, because these things are very important for us. Again, coming for the same type of study we have done for the cucumber also, that cucumber, it's a short duration crop, about 4 months crop. So I have just reported for one cycle, July to October. You can see that for 200 square meter area, how much crop water requirement per plant, for then total requirement for entire greenhouse, what should be the number of irrigation interval. All these things are very important for the growers. Now, in the fertigation scheduling, especially, I am reporting here for the major nutrients, NPK, that what should be the concentration that we use. So you can say these are concentration in the milligram per liter, that is ppm. So we have different stages of the crop: initial stage, vegetative stage, flowering stage, and harvesting stage. So we have the use of nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. Yeah, you can see that how it is gradually varying. We are starting the nitrogen from 100 ppm and going up to 180. Then phosphorus around 60 ppm, going up to 100. Potassium, there is a high demand for these type of crops. So these are the, so it is very important to know that to calculate the the doses in ppm for all these crops. And then our goal is that whatever the common water soluble fertilizer the farmers are using, whether it is urea, sulfate of potash, urea phosphate, calcium nitrate, they are very popularly being used by the farmers. So we are trying to use all these water soluble fertilizers that are being used by the farmers in our soil system. There is no use for some to buy some ready-made things. All the existing water soluble fertilizer that the farmers are using, they can be used in the soil system. And the only thing is that their dosage and then EC of the fertigation solution, EC of the pH of the media, pH of the fertigation, so these all things are very carefully need to be managed, and then it, these things are very important. Now, we have done similarly question and climatic parametric studies for chrysanthemum flower in grow bags inside semi-climate greenhouse, and then calculated the various dosage of chrysanthemum also for flowers. Here there is a list of micronutrients also. We have calculated the micronutrients, iron, manganese, zinc, copper, boron, what should be their doses in ppm and micromole per liter. So these things are very important for the soil system. Coming to our work on the indigenous automatic aeroponic system. So this is the indigenous automatic aeroponic system. We have totally designed and constructed this system at our center. And you can see in the picture, there is a automatic closed loop fertigation system with complete timer, pumps, tanks, and valves. And then this is a system where we can grow, you can in the picture, this is a picture of lettuce. We can grow in the inside a closed box that is a aeroponic system. This completely dark condition is created, and inside it, in the next slide, I will show you there are a very specialized nozzles we are using for giving the mist the crops, and the roots are hanging inside there. That's why this system is known as aeroponic system. So this is the indigenous aeroponic system. And see this, this is a small system that we have developed under the there is a National Agriculture Science Fund project, energy efficient polyhouse and aeroponic system, under which it's a wood box that is called wood plastic composite WPC box. It's a small box, and then about 2.5 into 1.25 meter into 1 meter, and then it has about 50 plants, and then automatic recirculating fertigation system with timer, nozzles, pumps, tanks, valves. And then very important thing is that they require round the ear misting. We put the 30 second on and then 4 to 6 minute off. And the total cost of the system is approximately 50,000 rupees. And we have found that the crop water requirement for the plants, it is about 4 liters per plant only for the lettuce crop. Whereas the same plant, if it is grown in drip fertigated open field, it is about 30 liters. So you can see that there is a huge water saving in this type of soilless system, aeroponic system, that the lettuce crop, if it is grown in open field with drip fertigation, the water demand is about 30 liters per plant. But the same plant, if it is grown in aeroponic system, there is a requirement of crop water requirement is only about 4 liters. And we get high yield also in comparison to 6 kg per meter square, in comparison to 4.5 kg per meter square in open field. So we can see that indigenous aeroponic system with automatic fertigation system, they require very specialized salts, and then these salts are to be mixed in solutions, and then you can see that these are the salts that we are using: monopotassium phosphate, monoammonium phosphate, potassium nitrate, potassium sulfate, all micronutrients, iron, calcium, magnesium, zinc, and these are the quantities that is mentioned for 1000 liter solution. And for the crop like lettuce, we do not allow the electrical conductivity of water to go more than 2 decisiemens per meter. So initially our water DC is about 1.4 decisiemens per meter, and finally it is 2 dB per liter. pH we have maintained in the range of 6.5, that is ideal for the crop like lettuce. So this type of thing is has to be very soundly practiced with the for the aeroponic system. You can see in the picture we have these are all the indigenous system that lettuce grown in the aeroponic system and hydroponic system inside the greenhouse. You can see in the you have a different view that we have a closed boxes and then NFT system and then aeroponic system in which we can grow the lettuce, leafy vegetables. Another type of cultivation that is aquaponic system cultivation. Basically, it is the system in which plants and fish are grown together in an integrated ecosystem. And as you know that vertical farming, as I told you initially, that it is the integration of hydroponics, aeroponics, aquaponics, soilless cultivation, and these are all the part of nowadays controlled environment and precision agriculture. Some of the major advantages that we get in the soilless cultivation is that increased crop production, protection from what we say that abiotic stresses, that is the weather related problems. They are environmental friendly. We can grow high quality produce round the year. Then conservation of resources. We have found that there is a less use of water, less use of nutrients, and that's why we can save the precious inputs. Then as I told you that vertical farming flexibility, all this technology we can use for vertical farming. Whatever the work related to soilless cultivation at our center at IRI, we are working on the last 5 to 6 years. We have published in the forms of various user-friendly bulletins. One of the bulletin is on technical bulletin on hydroponics. It is available in the Google also. And so we have collected all the indigenous work that we have done, whether it is related to soilless or grow bag, aeroponics or hydroponics, and reported in this type of in technical bulletin. And it is available, as I told you, in the Google also. Some literatures we have published for the farmers. They are very user-friendly leaflets in Hindi about the hydroponics and soilless systems. And coming to the conclusion, soilless technology is a potential sustainable technology for protected cultivation. It has high input efficiency and crop water productivity. Integral, as I told you that we have found that the crop water productivity is, that is a very important thing for the nowadays. It is very high for most of the horticulture crops that is being grown in soilless cultivation. Then integral component of vertical farming suitable, they're all suitable for automation with sensors and controllers. Indigenous models, sensors and controllers, they are needed because I told you that most of the, we require lots of indigenous models, whether it is a hydroponics model, aeroponics models to be developed in our country. We are using sensors, but and nowadays there is a requirement of lots of sensors, especially the nutrient sensors, major nutrient and micro sensors are lacking. Controllers we need, whether it is climate controller or it is fertigation controller. Most of the controller is still we are importing, and that's why there is a need for indigenous controllers. These technologies are popular among youths and farmers because it involves lots of technology, and that's why everyone feels pride in using it. And many youths, farmers, entrepreneurs are using this type of technology nowadays. This type of technology, it should be promoted to include in National Horticulture Mission and National Horticulture Board related to protected cultivation. Till date now, these are the two major agencies which are promoting protected cultivation technology in our country. They are the part of Ministry of Agriculture. But still now, the subsidies related to soilless cultivation for farmers are not available. So these are the two major board or organization There it should be promoted. We are also trying in different meeting that all this soilless cultivation now it should be included in the NHM and NHB related schemes and related projects. And finally, that this type of technology is suitable in post-COVID period for supply of fresh, leafy, and high-value vegetables, herbs, and seedlings that that is required nowadays. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Hassan. It was one of the very interesting topic I heard in soilless cultivation, especially the informations what you have given are tremendous. Unfortunate, it has not been utilized outside. For example, lastly, you made a statement saying that subsidy for soilless is not given. I disagree with that because we already have, if you want tomorrow, I can get 500 acres of polyhouses readily available, which you can make as a vertical farming. For example, per acre, we invest about 50 lakhs. That's about the estimate given by somebody to me. And normally when you want to, so let me complete. So yeah. I think the what information what you have given is excellent. This is what people are looking for, actually. You see, there are two, I see two parts of this, why the failure of polyhouses and how it is useful now we can convert to vertical farming, which will help very much, especially of COVID, you told. If you start now the work, probably after 6 months, we can get see something. Because you told about sensors are not existing. You told the importance about pH must be maintained and so much nutrients to be put inside and correct dosage, you told, mentioned. These are all very important. But you've been...
And disease is from the soil-based. Yeah. Disease is a major cause.
Yeah, disease. So I think excellent. I will put it to questions. I think very good. But only question is, I feel sad that the interaction between the industry or who want to promote it. Next step, I think probably TAC can take up few acres and show them really practically what is the problem. Maybe 10, 20 acres we can take or something like that and show really practically what is the instrumentation, the electronics required and how to guarantee the proper pH maintained, proper nutrients are going, time everything we can try. So I will ask now questions now, quick questions. I see a hand up with Dr. Narendra Shah, please.
Yeah, Dr. Murtaza, if you were to tell one of the biggest USP of this soilless agriculture, I mean, is it for landless farmers or is it for urbanites who do not have land or is it for small town people? What is the USP of this?
Yeah, the USP is that anywhere where the land is degraded or you have a rooftop with very less space, you can grow round the year any type of cultivation. That is its main USP. Whether it is your rooftop, whether it is the degraded land, or you have the greenhouse with soil problems, so anywhere you can use this technology, that is its biggest flexibility.
Thank you. I can add a few for Hassan, because from my experience, what I've seen and talked to people regarding this, number one, the nutrients cost will be reduced because using less nutrients, especially when you talked about aeroponics and all, the water consumption is very less. And the one more thing, controlled environment, like Dr. Singh told, controlled environment, so you don't get pests actually. But the problem we had in Kerala, for example, that had all the polyhouses, high humidity, they never had a problem of thinking about humidity will bring the pest also inside. So I think that will solve. Any other, one more question is from Dr. Sangeeta, please.
Yes, sir. Dr. Sahab, I wanted to ask about the soilless sensor, soilless moisture sensor. So I wanted to know what kind of soilless sensor you have. That's what you meant, isn't it? Moisture sensor?
Yeah, actually, madam, that the very common sensors that is being used for moisture measurement in the actual field, in the farmer's field, that is tensiometer. But unfortunately, tensiometer do not work in the soilless at all. So we have the lack of the soil moisture. So we can say the name is the soilless moisture sensor because there is no soil as such. So presently, we have very few sensors. So the main sensors we are handicapped is that we cannot use the tensiometer.
So which sensor did you use is my question. Which sensor?
it's a probe type sensor that we are using now. It gives in the soil the moisture in percentage.
It'll be challenging actually. It's a question very difficult to. There are sensors are required. He told already. I think anyway, it has to go in production. Actually, what you're looking at, not laboratory model. You're looking at production of. I told you, for example, 500,000 acres you can get tomorrow on rent from farmers in only in Maharashtra and Telangana. So think about rest of the places available to you. With little, you can go for soilless cultivation also or vertical farming. That's advantage. I'll allow one more question from Imran Khan. Please, can you ask questions fast because we have two more. Time is coming. I'll allow more speakers possible. Please. Yeah.
Yeah. Hi. Myself, Imran. I'm doing PhD from Shanghai University. My concern earlier, I was in IRI Pusa as a microbiologist. Question is the basic. You're hearing me?
Yes, sure.
So actually, I'm from the right now. I'm in Shanghai doing PhD here in nanobiotechnology. But I am from the Ghazipur in near the Varanasi. The place is known as a Ghazipur in Uttar Pradesh. So I have the land and all these things. The basic concern is that, suppose in the remote areas like Ghazipur or Varanasi, you do such type of things there. But the thing is that you need a market and all these things for that. I think that is another concern because if you grow such things, but you need a good market because everybody can't bear to buy these products. I think that is the one concern and another question related to the subsidy also about that is.
Okay.
For such type of farming, it is very important to have a good marketing system. So nowadays, Government of India is promoting cluster approach. So we are now focusing on whether all the growers to have a cluster. So when you have a good cluster, these clusters are now supported by farmers producers organizations, and then you can do the efficient marketing. Otherwise, individually, if you want to grow greenhouse and go for soilless farming, then of course it is difficult, and then marketing is the problem. So that's why our approach is the cluster approach.
Thank you. But I think marketing is a lot of work being done now. Actually, first start producing. By the time marketing is ready already, because people want this. So I think let's not worry about marketing much. We are going to have some more speakers webinar coming on marketing, logistics, and agriculture. And a lot of work is being done. So I don't think even banana, for example, how much they are transporting already. There's not a problem actually. Logistics is not a problem. You start growing. Next, I see somebody is there. I will allow Mintu Job. Question, please.
Sir, I have joined from Bursa Agriculture University, Ranchi.
Yes, please. Yeah, ask your question, please.
Hello.
Yes, sir,
is there any difference between hydroponics and aeroponics? Because whenever I have seen, people have shown hydroponics as aeroponics. So what is the basic difference? Is there any institute which does research or demonstration on aeroponics? Pure aeroponics.
Yes.
Yeah, actually, there is very clear cut difference. Hydroponics is a system where you grow the plants in some pipes in which the water is flowing. That is called nutrient water film technology and deep water flow culture. And in aeroponics, roots are hanging. So you have to give the water and nutrient by mist. So there is a very clear cut difference. And now many institutes are coming to the VR because we are part of ICR. In ICR, lots of work have been done on aeroponics on Central Potato Research Institute, because for aeroponics is a very potential technology for potato tubers. We are at Indian Agriculture Research Institute. We are working on basically on high-value vegetable crops. So hydroponics or aeroponics or soilless systems. So all things are available. You can come and then you can see it at IERI.
Thank you, Dr.
Hassan.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Simple to tell you. Water is flowing, put the nutrients, maintain the pH, grow there. That is called hydroponics. Aeroponics is hanging. You spray for a few seconds and give a break of few minutes, again spray it. So you need a high pressure sprayers. So they are not manufactured in India. That is the problem with aeroponics. And otherwise, aeroponics is very good. And I see one more question is Kumar. I will allow take one more question. Last question this is. Mr. Kumar, Pradeep.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, please.
Yes, please. I'm Pradeep Kumar from Kajri, Jodhpur. Actually, sir, I have a couple of things to just something to supplement because we are also working on hydroponics and protected cultivation over here. It had been better, Dr. Hassan. First of all, I would like to congratulate and for give a brief detail, a technical detail rather, because I have been listening, a lot of webinars have been going on this vertical farming and the hydroponics, but none of the person giving technical detail what solution they are making and all. So I wanted to know more about the aeration, air content in the media and the temperature, what temperature you are keeping, maintaining, and how you are maintaining the temperature, because temperature is very, very, very serious issues in terms of oxygen availability. If you are maintaining temperature at a certain level or a range, then the certain amount of oxygen is there. Otherwise, we have a loss of nutrient absorption, means absorption of nutrients are not proper. So it is one thing. And second thing is for vertical farming, when we are going for the lettuce, the problem is, and what, because there are some entrepreneurs in Jodhpur and Jaipur who are working, but the major concern is after winter, what they want to take in this NFT or aeroponic system. So this is another issue. Just the winter, in 3-4 months, they can harvest a number of vegetable, English vegetable. But during summer or rainy season, it is very, very difficult to take any of the such kind of high value crop. And third thing is that the nutrient composition, it and the moisture content, we need to keep. We have also used the TDR that is giving the, nowadays it is highly accurate, and we have also ordered, okay. And we are to get. And I also answer the madam's question. TDR is the best among all the available for it is giving very
be brief.
Mr. Kumar, let us stop at TDR. We have used some universities use mass sensing. We'll come back to that afterwards. This is very technical. I think you can go one into one and then you can discuss. I think I stop here the question.
I will reply in the coming to your first question is that because temperature is very, that's why commercially this type of technology, they has to be adopted in climate controlled greenhouse, especially in the northern Indian condition. And temperature is very important, not only the growing temperature inside the greenhouse, but the solution temperature is also very important. Let me tell you that for the solution temperature for fertigation, whether it is for hydroponics or aeroponics, we try to maintain it that it do not go more than 28 degrees.
Dr. Hazan, sorry to interrupt again, because there are two technical, temperature, humidity, so many parameters. So I think we need solution for them. So I will stop here this one and ask Professor Gajan Singh, you want to say some few words?
No, I think it should close now.
Okay, Dr. Indramani, please, I think.
Thank you, friends. Today we had, both the speakers made justice. With the participants, and I will again repeat that this processing aspect has become very, very important. And as I said in the beginning, that there has been sweeping reforms in agri value, this value chain of agri produce. As I said, that government has earmarked 1 lakh crore rupees to build the infrastructure of farm gate. Seamless movement of agri produce inside the states, across the states, and two major changes have been done. One is that the stock limit of the processors has been lifted, and second is contract farming has become legal. That means it may be a situation where agri processor may hire land and start producing and for their own industry, or some farm changes will come. Again, I want to emphasize that technology will be needed. Anything will not the changes will not come through investment only. They will come through technology, and more importantly, indigenous technology, as Dr. Jha said. So this is the time to really wake up and if I say backup means this is the job of egg engineers, that you know, to take up these things and come up with technology. That is what the purpose of this webinar. Regarding this soilless cultivation, I have visited Dr. Hassan's work, and as I said, that they are very useful. And one thing that you know, question in the beginning was, what for normal farmer? Yes, this can be adopted by normal farmers also. To the extent that Dr. Hassan offered me that you can put one of this structure in your balcony and can produce your own lettuce. So means from you know, this city dwellers they can use, and farmers they can start. But I do feel that there is a lot to be done, Dr. Sayyad, in this also, lot to be done. And realizing this, realizing the importance, recently I had discussion with in IDEA, there is a thinking to have an, am I audible?
Yeah. You're audible.
Yeah, there is a plan to have a network project on this vertical farming, in, which will include the aeroponics, hydroponics, etc., and different institute will be integrated. And there is serious thinking that you know, an integrated research should be done. So if it is done, then definitely this will lead to technology for the individual, for farmers, for industry, for everybody. Another important thing is that what we had whole day we were discussing with Dr. Sayyad and others is subsidy. Subsidy is haunting because there is still feeling that it is not reaching to the farmers. Benefit is not reaped by the farmers. So I had in the day discussion with Dr. P.K. Joshi, who is a great agricultural economist, followed by Dr. Ashok Lathi, who is again one of the top agricultural economists of the country. And despite their busyness, they had said they will find out time to join this webinar. And then I had a discussion with some industry, Dian tractor industry particularly. And much to my astonishment, I came to know that tractor industry has given in writing to the government that do away with subsidy. We don't want subsidy. So, and other side, Dr. Hassan was mentioning this needs subsidy. That means there is total darkness in with respect to subsidy. And I personally feel, and Dr. Professor Gajen Singh has been advocating that this Baisakhi must go, or it should be put in a very different form. Like tractor industry, I was talking to TMA chief, and he said that we will rather advocate that subsidy should be given to the farmers at the custom hiring level. So if you are, whatever custom hiring charges you are taking, give subsidy to him, so that with a reverse, in the sense, reverse means more subsidy at farmers level, so more farmers will be engaged in custom hiring, more need of tractors will be there, industry will be benefited more. So something like this should come. So we have a discussion on this by these people, including industry people. And we will see that at least one outcome of this webinar will be that giving a clear cut picture that what is happening in subsidy, what should be done by involving different stakeholders, starting from industry to the government and to the end users, including farmers, representative and others. With this, I'm really very happy with today's presentation and discussion, and what all we did whole day, Dr. Sayyad. Particularly this on these all issues. Thank you very much for joining us. On 10th, we will meet on with another topic, 10th of this, and then next others on subsidy and other issues we will plan. We are thinking about this land and water management aspects also. So we'll get, so we will bring some few, you know, some speakers on this, so that this area should also be covered. In processing, we will need more, I think. I know this was one area, one aspect, but storage and other things, we can have more people, because as I said, that this whole government has thought how to match those expectation of the reforms and reforms in regulation, reforms in the government act, how we are going to match with the technology. I think that should be our motto ultimately. With this, once again, I thank you all for joining, and thank you very much, and see you on 10th. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, all of you. Thank you.